competition, the Europe summer season now comes to an epic conclusion. We've seen the world's top Hearthstone players compete with strategy and wit as competitors rise and fall in emotional victories. Now it's time to crown a new champion. 8 players from across Europe will battle to earn a chance at glory and a share of the $100,000 prize pool. Pull up a chair and catch all the action. The Hearthstone Europe Summer Championship starts right now.
Greetings from the fireside and welcome everybody to the Europe Summer Championships for 2016. We have gathered 8 of the players from around the European continent to see who will get that last seasonal spot for BlizzCon later in the Hearthstone World Championships and battle out for $100,000. Joining me on stage is the said 8 players hailing from all corners of the region. Let's go ahead and introduce them so you guys get familiar with the 4 quarterfinals that'll be happening later today. So starting to my far right, we have our last quarterfinals, hailing from Ukraine, a returned finalist at the Europe Championships. It's Dr. Hippie up against Like a Boss, the passionate Greek player. To my right as well, we have our third match of the day. One of the players was picked by Savitz as the French player Diz Demon, going up against Greyjay, a player from Ukraine. To my far left, we have our second match of the day. From Germany, we have Viper up against his opponent in I Kill You from the Polish community. Our first, and certainly not the least, is another returning finalist. We have the cheeky lad himself, George C, up against Sarah C from Germany as well. Thanks so much for joining me on stage, gentlemen. Please exit to your right, but George and Sarah C, please stay. We're gonna get you guys started in just a second. Now, Sarah C, we'll go ahead and start off the question with you. You actually came in here as a player that we weren't expecting. You only had a week's of preparation, but at the same time, we've had players who come in here go very far, not stand for the Winter Championships. So do you feel like this could be your second redemption chance to go all the way?
I mean, first of all, it's Sarah C, not Sarah C, but Frodan. But yeah, I'm feeling good. It's probably a slight disadvantage. Could have had more practice, more time, but I'm confident I'll just play.
You are aware that the last player's name that I mispronounced excessively also went to the finals?
Yeah, sure. I'll just go like him.
And there you go. The Frodan blessing has been placed. George C., why are you so cheeky? Why are you back here at the Summer Championships?
I don't know. I played Yogg.
And you were rewarded. The faith has been placed. George, coming here back-to-back seasons has been an accomplishment done by just a few individuals. How are you going to be able to take it all the way this time?
I don't know. Just play my best, give myself my best percentage chance of winning, and let the cards decide.
And there it is. George's going to play his best, and we'll see what happens. So go ahead, shake hands, guys. And let's get ready to get this championship underway. Let's take a look at what these guys had to say about each other before we go into our first match.
What do you think about your first opponent, George?
Our lineups are actually surprisingly close.
Our lineups are pretty similar in some respects, so there'll be lots of mirror matches which might be pretty volatile.
We have 4 mirror decks, actually. He has a Freeze Mage, I have a Zoo.
I think my decks have like a higher skill cap, just because I have Freeze Mage in the lineups. It gives me like a really small edge in that respect.
Not the fact that it's the mirror gives me an edge or not.
He beat you in prelims.
Yeah, got the rematch going.
I would like a repeat result of what happened before.
We have a story to tell. If I beat him, I'll be happy, right?
You just gotta believe that you can play to the best of your ability. That's ultimately what it will come down to.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back. Joining me for the first match, it's George C. versus Rossi. It's Brian Kibler. Kibler, are you excited for this one?
I am, absolutely. This is, as they said, a rematch. And seeing if George will be able to improve upon his performance from the last championship.
Yeah, he finished 5th-8. He lost in the first round. So he feels like he's prepared a little bit better this time around. Maybe had some mismatchups in the last championship. So definitely a favorite coming in, especially since he's the top point earner out of anybody in the summer championship as far as Hearthstone Championship Tour points goes. And he already beat Sarasi
He did. Yeah, I think the interesting thing about both this matchup and sort of George's possible performance in the event in general will be that Freeze Mage deck. Mm. Freeze Mage is a deck that even Freeze Mage loyalists like Dr. Hippie have sort of moved away from. But George still thinks it's positioned to do well in this event, despite the fact that there's so much Control Warrior, so much fewer Zoo decks than we've seen in the past.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see. You know, you can look at how their deck lineups line up. You saw in their little piece there that they have four essentially mirror decks. And if you just go linearly and say, well, the fifth deck, how it lines up, is unfavorable for George, you can't really look at that because it's mm-hmm. a best of seven. So the likelihood that they get that matchup is actually small. Mm-hmm. A lot of it depends on where George can land that Freeze Mage. And if he can take a win in a match that might be a little bit unfavored for the deck. If he can win against, say, an aggressive Shaman deck, then he might be in a good spot. So because I think he sort of has to ban the Warrior in this case, because of the fact that Freeze Mage just won't pick up a Warrior. But can he go with a different strategy?
Well, I actually was talking to him yesterday, and he said that he felt like Sarasi was not particularly experienced playing Control Warrior, and that he felt like he would rather potentially ban one of the other classes. I actually didn't have a chance to see the exact ban, but he had said that he thought that he might leave it open to Sarasi simply because he felt like he would not necessarily pilot it optimally, mm-hmm. Even if the matchups on paper would be better for him.
So he did go ahead and ban the Warrior away. Okay. So didn't go with that strategy, but definitely an interesting choice. George is probably the most confident Freeze Mage player. Let's go ahead and go into game number one of the first match of the day here. It's going to be George with his Control Warrior, and he's going to be going up against the Druid from Sarasi.
And this is a matchup that has changed dramatically with the shift toward the Malygos strategy as opposed to the token strategy. When Druid was built around the token strategy, it had far more ability to present threats at various stages of the game. Now, the Malygos version is kind of a limited pool of threats. The really key element for the Malygos deck in this matchup is getting a big card draw turn with Auctioneer to be able to generate too many threats for the Warrior to be able to answer with the cards that they actually draw themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Blood of Brave, also an interesting choice. Blood of Brave is a card that's long been gone from the meta, mostly because it was played in Tempo Warrior a lot, and Tempo Warrior has basically just transitioned into Dragon Warrior, and their four slot was already pretty clogged up with Twilight Guardian and Corcoran Elite, so that card has made a comeback, and it's actually quite powerful. Bloodhoof Brave was included in almost every Warrior deck for the first couple months of Whispers of the Old Gods.
I think that George's build of Control Warrior is specifically designed to be effective in a world where there are mid-range Shaman decks and things like that. He even has Sogoth the Slitherer, which is a powerful tool against other control decks, as well as an unhexable big threat when you're playing against decks that are looking to attrition you out like mid-range Shaman can do.
Yeah, it's interesting to sort of see the evolution of Warrior across the past month and even just across the past week of the championships where Dragon Warrior was so popular last week, and now it's all control. Even in the North American scene, like if you look at Ladder, players are starting to shift, even though Dragon Warrior was popular like a week ago, because of how Shaman is shifting, I think. Where Control Warrior, where it was once touted as being a tough matchup against Shaman, is now pretty good.
Yeah, a lot of that has to do with the specifics of a lot of the mid-range Shaman decks being built to beat other built aggressive decks with things like Maelstrom Portal, significant number of Lightning Storms, which are quite weak. That was a very good result for George from that Ironforge Portal, mostly because it's a dragon, but also because it's statistically much larger than most 4-drops you get.
Yeah, usually the 4-drops are the best of the ones that have a downside. Hungry Dragon, of course, summoning a 1-drop for your opponent. Things like Flame Wreath Faceless can be really good from, well, are always really good
from
Ironforge
Portal. That's only a 7-7 for 5.
Yeah.
That's, I mean, you can do better.
Still above average, and you also gain 4. But yeah, you don't get the downside of the overload, so George already off the bat to a pretty good start in this matchup. He's going to not have initiative, but still be relatively comfortable against the Druid.
Though Sarasi has some powerful tools in his hand, Fandral is one of the powerful cards in this matchup for the Druid as well. Being able to Fandral, in particular with Raven Idol can allow you to accumulate additional resources, and this really is a resource fight. The warrior doesn't really have the tools to put a ton of pressure on the druid, so they need to try to just win a long attrition-based game. And the druid has a lot of tools to draw cards, but they have a lot of kind of air in their deck. You know, the mana acceleration cards like Moonfire Living Roots obviously pair very well with Malygos, but when the warrior is able to build up so much armor, that burst damage sometimes just isn't enough.
Yeah, they don't really have many minions. Their minions are very powerful, but there's very little of them. You talk about Fandral, the double Arcane Giants, the Malygos, and the Yogg-Saron. That's effectively it. Mire Keepers, yeah, but those are really not that big of a threat, even if they're played with a 2-2 later on in the game. So George can, you can usually hold on to removal a lot and always have removal to line up for big threats. And so as long as you do get that armor total up to a point and don't fall too far behind early, then you're usually in a pretty decent spot in this matchup in particular.
And one thing that's interesting about the dynamic of this particular matchup, because the Malygos Druid deck is capable of so much burst damage, you kind of want to use your resources a bit differently than sometimes you would in previous Warrior versus Druid matchups. You don't want to use your life total quite as liberally, because your life total is actually quite important against surviving a Malygos burst turn.
Malygos does have a limited amount of damage, but a good point that you mentioned earlier was that warriors don't put on pressure. And that allows you to have a lot of time as the druid. You can make some ridiculous plays with Innervates and Raven Idols if you pick up extra burst damage from Malygos, where you can deal, you know, 30-plus damage in a single turn.
Though that is one Moonfire used for Sarasi, so George very likely paying close attention to just what the total damage output possibility is for Sarasi in terms of his Malygos turn. And then Arcane Giant follows that removal. Arcane Giant has probably been the most prominent card from the Karazhan adventure, in particular in these druid decks. Just such a powerful threat that can come down in the same turn as other spells because of the cost reduction.
Yeah, spells that naturally like to err on the side of being spell heavy, Arcane Giant is just sort of a natural fit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as long as you're having a relatively late game plan. Doesn't really fit in like tempo mage, even though you're very spell heavy, because it's not a tempo card. It's you don't play it very early on in the game, and a lot of times if you get to that point as tempo mage, you're already falling too far behind to really make a comeback. So druid, it just seems like a perfect fit almost.
Yeah, druid just has so many powerful spells. There's obviously the ramp cards, which let you play it earlier just naturally in terms of the mana reduction. But when you wild growth effectively reduce the cost by 2, innervate. You saw just last turn, Innervate effectively was worth 3 mana for the Arcane Giant and allowed Sarasi to play it alongside his hero power usage that turn.
So taking a look at sort of the overall game plans here, Sarasi has used a Moonfire, so it looks like he is trying to play the battle of getting resources out of George and then having sort of an unanswerable threat or unanswerable damage. And, I mean, this Azure Drake has lived for a long time.
Yeah.
It's done like 12 damage almost.
Yeah, and being able to stick repeat damage sources is crucial for the druid because, as we mentioned, the warrior is capable of getting just a big armor turtle built up, and that makes the burst damage plan for Malygos very difficult to pull off. If the druid is able to connect a significant number of times with something like an Azure Drake, it's very valuable. And here, as we mentioned, the Raven Idol off of Fandral just giving Sarasi more resources to use, and ooh, this is an interesting choice because he already has a pretty big hand. Nourish is a card that you will very often want to take off of Raven Idol, but you also need to keep in mind that you are very likely to draw your entire deck in this matchup before you're really going to do anything. And he does choose to take the Living Roots here to increase his damage potential with the Malygos, though it's not the most over. Oh my! Well, that was a big card off of Mulch. Tyrion picked up by George C, and down comes the Sog Champ. Sogoth the Slitherer, a huge brick wall against a spell-based deck like this druid.
Wow. So that is really impactful. You can see George trying to like hold back a smirk as the Tyrion came into his hand. I mean, that's sort of the risk that you take when you play Mulch, I suppose. You know, it's a very powerful removal spell. There's not many hard removal spells that are that sort of cheap in the game, being at 3 mana. So sometimes you just give your opponent really good stuff, and Tyrion in Control Warrior is actually absurd. If that was a warrior card to be played in almost every single deck.
I think if that were, like, in almost any class, you'd play it in at least some some version of the decks. It's a druid card, pretty good to ramp into. Mm-hmm. I would play that as a priest card for sure.
Well, obviously. But yeah, that's a pretty big 1-2 punch with the Sugoth the Slitherer into Tyrion Forgering. So George in a fantastic spot in this game. He does need to get his life total.
One of the things that's actually particularly powerful about Sugoth is how good it is against Yogg. Yogg-Saron cannot target Sugoth with spells. So you see a little smile and nod from Cerasi, and George C. Breaking a little smirk of his own. I mean, this may very well be the Yogg turn. And there it is. But crucially, Cerasi chose not to attack with his Ivory Knight first, which doesn't get any damage on the Sugoth. Bull. So now, if he had attacked, Sugoth would have died. But it's entirely possible that he loses his Ivory Knight. And, there's a Pyroblast. Where's it headed? Oh, Tyrion goes down.
Wow, another Fork Lightning, but doesn't do anything if there's not two targets on the board.
But Entomb doesn't hit it. It can't target it. Sugoth is the bane of Yogg-Saron, but it looks like Ivory Knight survived all that, and Heroic Strike also gave Cerasi four attacks. So he can choose which way he actually wants to remove this Sugoth here. So pretty good result for Cerasi there.
Yeah, it cleared the board and left him with his Yogg still intact. He did take some damage from the fireball to the face. He changed his hero power to shadow form, which I think is actually just better. You know, you don't get the extra armor gain from shapeshift, but that doesn't really make a big deal. And the two damage from shadow form might be able to chip away at the armor total a little bit better and be able to pick off things that might be hiding behind a taunt. So, Cerasi, that's a... It's pretty early in the game for Yogg-Saron, but I feel like that's a good choice against Control Warrior because you want to have more time to use the resources that Yogg might give you.
Yeah, one of the problems with Yogg against Control Warrior can often be if you are playing a very resource-oriented game, spending a lot of resources to draw cards, you can just get to the point where you fatigue yourself to death. And Cerasi is just going to go ahead and drop Malygos.
Whoa.
Fires off his Living Roots to clear this. This is a pretty bold decision here, because Malygos does represent a huge portion of his win condition. He's already lost some of his bigger minions. This may be a brawl for George C. if he isn't able to find an execute or a shield slam right here. He finds shield slam, so he is able to take Malygos off the board, and that's a pretty big deal, because now Cerasi is pretty limited in terms of just how much damage he can generate. He doesn't have that many big threats left in his deck.
Yeah, he has Emperor Thorsand, one Arcane Giant, and that's effectively it. You know, like Yogg-Saron's gone, Malygos is gone, one Arcane Giant's gone, and drawing cards, while it's useful, is not necessarily that helpful in this matchup because you need threats. And this might be one of those instances where, since Malygos is gone, Ravenidol is going to be used to pick up the minion.
It's also worth noting that Cerasi is very low. He lost the ability to shapeshift and gain armor, and he's at just 13. George C. has the Ashbringer, and then Gore Howl to follow up. He actually is very, very, with the Bash in hand, he actually has lethal damage over two turns if Cerasi can't gain any life.
That's very true. George is going to go ahead and use the Brawl. This is probably the best it's going to get. We've talked about over the course of the match how the Druid deck is not very minion heavy, so using it to remove one big minion is usually going to be the best case scenario. But George does have lethal next turn, so unless Cerasi finds a way to heal up, he will be dead, but I don't think healing up is really on his radar, considering 8 damage is not something you usually play around.
He finds there's no life gain here. He only has one copy of Feral Rage left in his deck that can possibly gain him life, and it looks like Cerasi is just trying to play the aggressive direction, and George C. has Gore Howl Bash, and after all that crazy Yogg and Mulch shenanigans, it will be Gore Howl that finishes off the game, giving George C. a 1-0 lead over Cerasi.
Yeah, a really interesting first game. George C., impressive performance with the Warrior, but got a little help from the Mulch, and of course the Hungry Dragon from the Ironforge portal early on gave a little bit of a leg up. But definitely Control Warrior showing its strength and sort of the battles of attrition moving forward. So George is going to go up 1-0.
One interesting thing there, you know, we're talking about how little pressure the Warrior deck typically does put on, but George recognized he was so far behind in the attrition battle, especially after that Yogg-Saron, that he recognized, okay, well, my opponent's lost his ability to gain life. It's time for me to go aggressive and just close out the game in a couple of turns.
Yeah. So George's up 1-0. Sarasi's going to have to fight his way back. He's used to being in this position, though, against George. We're going to learn a little bit more about Sarasi right after this.
So playing in the event, what was going through your head? Were you expecting to make it as far as you did? Were you confident going into, on day one, your matches?
No, I didn't expect to get that far at all. The summer season was actually the first season for me that I ever collected more points than just the standard one you get from Legend. So yeah, started playing those Open Cups for fun, finished top 100 in June. That was enough, so I just gave it a shot. And on the first day, I just won.
You just won.
Just won all the games.
So there are some players here who have a lot of experience. Is that experience sort of intimidating to you?
I mean, that's for sure. I think Hearthstone especially, it comes a lot from experience. Players who play the game since 3 years. I started playing the game 1 year ago. A big difference, I think so, yeah.
What do you think your play style is in Hearthstone? Do you think you tend to be to take more risks, or do you tend to go for the safe play most of the time?
How I decide to do my play, it's often just a feeling. Like, I'm not the super analyzer. It's just a feeling like, oh, whoa, my opponent is ahead now. I'm ahead here. Not analysis and counting all the time. It's sometimes just a feeling. It just clicks in your head, so I gotta do this now.
Says it's just a feeling. That's how he knows what the right play is. He's not all about that analysis.
In some cases, that's the sort of thing that you'll often hear from players who have a ton of experience. Because you've just been in the sort of situations so many times, you don't necessarily have to analyze every single situation. Though Sarasi was saying that he only started playing competitively fairly recently, so perhaps he's just more intuitive than analytical in general.
Well, he also had to sort of be instinctual with his decks too, not finding out that he was going to be at the championship until just a week ago. So having won that decider match between the 9th and 12th place finishers, so definitely a little bit less time to prepare. But he says he's confident, so we'll see if he can manage to overcome. But we're going to move into game number two here. George with his sort of signature freeze mage at this point, and Sarasi with the hunter.
Yeah, speaking of confidence and time to prepare, George C very confident in his freeze mage deck and has played more with this deck than many players have just played games of Hearthstone. Mm-hmm. He is absolutely enthralled with the gameplay of Freeze Mage, says that it's kind of the reason he plays Hearthstone. He just loves this style of deck so much.
Yeah, he really thinks that he can get an edge as far as skill goes in this matchup, where he can sort of outthink his opponents. He thinks that Freeze Mage is favored in almost every matchup, which is a little bit weird. We talked about earlier how he said he might not even ban Control Warrior. He did. He lied to us, but at the same time, just having that confidence in yourself when playing a deck can sometimes be really important.
And he was actually saying that when he was over at the Blizzard offices for the opportunity to talk to some of the developers before coming here, that he played against Ben Brode, playing Freeze Mage against Ben Brode's Hunter deck. And Ben Brode, Animal Companion, got Huffer, and George C. just fireballed him in the face and just killed him like 3 turns later. It's like, this is just, I'm going to send a message right here. I'm going to let you know what this game is going to be about.
Well, I was going to say, if he gets fireball off the top and that's a Huffer, we might be seeing a sort of a repeat of that. But yeah, George very confident in this matchup. Also, looking at Sarasi's hunter list, it's very mid-rangey. It runs Barnes, it runs a single copy of Unleash the Hounds, as opposed to a few copies with Knife Juggler, as some players have decided to bring here. So definitely sort of standard from what we've seen recently, and maybe with the exception of Teray at the America's Championship.
He does have even one copy of Argent Horse Rider, as well as two copies of Deadly Shot. Those are actually cards that are fairly important in the Freeze Mage matchup, just giving you a little bit more reach and a little bit more ability to deal with Doomsayer. In a lot of matchups that are minion-based, Doomsayer can be absolutely crucial to your ability to win. This is one where Doomsayer is often just totally ineffective because the 100x is so easily able to deal with it and has so much burst damage from hand that can finish you off without actually having to rely on minion damage.
Also, just a lot of Death Rattle minions as well that'll leave stuff behind when they die, like Infested Wolf and
Scar. Savannah Jaime coming down.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. Strassi actually has purposefully made some of his deck choices with Hunter to make Barnes a little bit better. He says, usually when you build a Hunter deck, you have a deck that's filled with 27 cards, and you have to bring three bad cards, is his exact words. There's a Evolve Kobold. That's an interesting tech decision.
And that draw is actually pretty important for George, because this isn't a matchup where he's going to be able to play like just the slow and steady, going to grind you out because of the threat of so much burst damage coming from the Hunter. And Evolve Kobold dramatically increases the burst damage that the Freeze Mage deck is capable of. In particular, alongside Frostbolt plus Ice Lance, you can do so much damage for a very cheap overall cost.
And it fits George's playstyle. He says that he plays Freeze Mage a little bit differently than a lot of players in the fact that he recognizes the win condition of when to just throw Burn at the face a lot quicker than other Freeze Mage players.
And I expect we'll see just Frost Nova Fireball here. Oh, he did draw Doomsayer, so maybe that mixes things up a little bit. May just be Blizzarding. Okay.
That's interesting. He's playing very quickly. Maybe that's because he's played so many games, so he can recognize the correct play in his mind a lot quicker. But Freeze Mage, that's a lot of options in his hand. Maybe not so much if you look at most of those cards just being pretty one-dimensional burn spells. But at the same time, very fast play.
Yeah, George does have access to Alexstrasza, so he might be looking to hope that he can draw, say, Ice Block for the Alexstrasza with Ice Block up alongside the Frost Nova he does have in his hand. Serasi is at a point where he is getting into the ability to play those Call of the Wild, so even if his board does get frozen, he can generate additional threats and put a lot of damage potential onto George.
All right, so now we're getting into the tough turns, because he doesn't have enough damage yet to start going with the burn plan. He doesn't have Ice Block available to develop, so he can't safely play Alexstrasza on 9 because he'd be taking a lot of damage. So this is one of those tougher positions. Ice Barrier is not going to buy him nearly enough time, especially going into those turn 8s. So he might have to try and draw a little bit more here with Acolyte of Pain, but then how does he win from there? Because he doesn't really have enough time.
Yeah, he'd need to find more freezes. And the problem is that freezes aren't even necessarily that good once your opponent's getting to the Call of the Wild stage of the game, because you're not actually preventing your opponent from dealing significant damage to you. And then Serasi has the ability to just Deadly Shot this, and a lot of burn too. There's a Quick Shot picked up alongside that Kill Command, so George C at just 17 life. It's interesting too, because given the fact that he has High Main and Infested Wolf on the board, allowing the Doomsayer to go off isn't even necessarily that bad.
Maybe he's thinking that if George C were to go for that play, he would have a board sweep coming in for the next turn. And George C is just going to go for it. So he's effectively at 23. There's 9. There's 12 damage on the board with his burn spells. That's going to be 20, 22.
Is he actually one damage off here?
Is there any other combination?
The really interesting thing for Serasi here, I think if he'd actually just played Call of the Wild as a burn spell last turn rather than trying to protect his board, he would have been able to potentially...
I think he would have... Yeah, that would have been more than enough, I think, because he'd still be left with 2 2-2s and then 2 1-1s.
Or even just fired off his burn spells last turn. Because last turn, he was just conservative. He just played the Deadly Shot and used his Hero Power. He didn't play the Quick Shot or Kill Command, which were available to him. At least one of them, he could have also played that turn. And now he's mana constricted. Now he's at the point where, if he had more mana, or his opponent was at slightly less life, he could potentially end the game. But here, he is in a position where he doesn't really have quite enough, I think. He has the ability to... he's going to go ahead and Call of the Wild, and yeah, we see George C. He knows it's over now that the barrier is going to protect him, And he's got 15 points of burn in his hand. So this game looked like it was going Cerasi's way for most of this game. But George C., despite not even finding Ice Block, is able to maneuver in such a way that he can Alexstrasza his opponent and just fire off that burn at the face.
Yeah, and playing quickly at that as well, recognizing how he's going to win this game, even if it's, you know, that wasn't like the highest percent chance to win because of how much burn damage there was available. He calculated sort of what he was able to play around and has exactly enough damage. And George is going to take a 2-0 lead in the series. And importantly, taking a win with Freeze Mage, which was seemingly on paper one of the tougher decks against Cerasi's lineup.
I'm just trying to think through what options Cerasi had available to him in terms of how he might have been able to play around that a little bit differently. Because he also didn't know that that was Ice Barrier. But he has to think, okay, if my opponent has Alexstrasza and that's Ice Block, what can I do anyway? Mm-hmm. So, you know, what way, now that I'm in this position, can I win the game? And I'm not really sure exactly what he could have done, but it feels like something could have been different.
Yeah, definitely. So Cerasi is going to have to fight his way back from an 0-2 deficit, and we're going to move into game number 3 right after this.
How did you feel after your performance in spring?
Most people would feel like pretty sad, but I wasn't too worried about it. Like, it's all part of like a learning experience.
The winning moment of the preliminaries.
Oh no.
I want to hear your thoughts.
It was a beautiful moment, wasn't it? Brings a tear to my eye.
It was. It was a beautiful moment of fist bumping.
Absolute
power.
Perfection, yeah. Mm.
Do you feel like now that you've qualified a second time that people are going to be expecting you to win?
I mean, some people have said I have a good chance. Some people said I'm favorite, blah, 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 whatever. Like, to me, you just gotta filter that out and just play the best you can. Like, it's no point getting hyped up by other people or other people telling you to, you know, that you might win. You gotta go and like do it.
Was it tough to balance your life at home with keeping up as being a top level Hearthstone player?
I don't know, Hearthstone's one of those things, like, you should retain like most of the skillful aspects of the game, like decision making. Even if the cards change, like the meta changes, you kind of know like sequencing how the mechanics work. So it isn't even bad if I get like a week or 2 weeks where I'm averaging like half an hour a day, whatever. When you get back into it, you just have to apply the same mindset you would. So it's not forgetting that and how you approach the game.
You will have sort of a second chance, even if you don't win this, you still get to go to the last call. Does that weigh into your mind at all?
It's like less pressure in a sense. So like when I'm playing my games, I won't feel like I need to win kind of thing. If I mess up, that's my own fault. But it also means I'm more likely to make better plays because I won't be as nervous.
So sort of like a little bit of an advantage knowing that for all these guys, it's their last chance. But for you, it's not necessarily.
Yeah, feels good, man.
Feels good, man.
Thank you, Kipler.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Brought a tear to my eye.
My fist made a beautiful appearance in that video, as did some random persons at George's venue where he participated at the preliminary. The cringe fist, as he calls it. Beautiful moment of raw emotion. But yeah, moving into game number 3 here. George has a 2-0 lead over Cerasi, and notably picking up a win with Freeze Mage in that game number 2. So game number 3 now is going to be Hunter for George and Warlock, the Zoo Warlock for Cerasi.
This is a matchup that generally considered to be usually in the favor of the Warlock. Most of the Hunter decks these days tend to be a little bit heavier on the curve, build up to high main and Call of the Wild, though George is an excellent low curve hand right here.
Yeah, and this is what Hunters have been trying to do It's not really for Zoo because it's kind of gone out. It's mostly for Shaman.
Right.
But that's sort of why Zoo has fallen out, because naturally decks have to beat Shaman. And a lot of the cards that beat Shaman also beat Zoo. And also, Shamans are teching against Zoo most of the time, even without even trying anymore, because how powerful the card Maelstrom Portal is.
Yeah, and George C. with a Animal Companion here. Pretty much anything is good. Yeah. The Misha here. Definitely quite good against Cerasi's board, in particular given that Cerasi currently has no attack boosts, so will not be able to get rid of it without losing both of his minions.
And now George actually has an opportunity to use Deadly Shot effectively against a Zoodeck, which is a rarity, and removing one of the more powerful minions in the deck. So definitely a very good start for the young British player.
Yeah, a good early curve. You know, unleash the hounds in his hand for if things get a little bit out of control. Maybe not as powerful as it once was because a lot of warlocks are cutting Forbidden Ritual.
Yeah, that Malkazar's Imp for Sarasi is actually a pretty big deal given the fact that he has Doomguard in hand. And the Doomguard will allow him to get a big threat down and immediately reload. George picks up a Leok, which does not give him the ability to actually remove that Imp. So I imagine we'll just see that Doomguard come down, and it's just a 5-7 charge for free, thanks to the fact that Imp reloads his hand.
Yeah, which is very powerful. He's thinking about it, and he's like, well, maybe I need Knife Juggler, maybe I need Possessed Villager. No, you don't.
You know, you need a 5-7 charge.
Well, he gets a Possessed Villager back.
Like I said, free.
It's free.
And while George had a pretty good start, that Doomguard really looking like it can turn things around. Kill Command going to take it off the board. But crucially, Sarasi still has several cards in hand thanks to the reload potential of that Imp on the discard trigger.
Mm. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, hi.
Wow.
Well, speaking of reloads and Doomguards, that's a good one. And Sarasi actually has the choice of whether he wants to play one of his one drops from his hand first. He looks like he's going to drop the Villager. It's an interesting decision because Sarasi can just trade these in for two new cards from his deck. Mm. But he would like to use his mana this turn efficiently, and looks like he's just going to go ahead and play. Well, maybe not. Yeah, Villager does come down, and now it's Doomguard time. Reloading once again, only drawing one card since he only discarded one card. Mm.
Darkshire Librarian drawn, so we're getting a showcase here of the power of the discard Warlock, or the discard versions of Warlock, when they work.
Yeah.
Which actually was quite a bit of a struggle the last time, the last championship in Americas, where it was very inconsistent. Even though it did make it to the finals, it was the weakest deck in both players that made it to the finals lineups.
Well, one of the things that we saw that was different in their versions of Discard Warlock, Hot Meowth was playing the Demon Fire version, whereas Sarasi is playing more of the sort of traditional zoo that has the discard elements. Mm-hmm. And the Demon Fire is actually, and Lance Carriers are some of the cards that kind of we felt like sat in players' hands in situations where they were perhaps more powerful than other things, though. Also, we saw that clutch draw of Demon Fire to kill a Doomsayer as well. But this is something that Zoo players have hated their entire lives, the Juggle Unleash turn. George very far behind on this board, but able to have a big swing here.
Wow.
As he is just slaughtering Sarasi's board. Two hits on the Imp Gang boss, though. That is, you know, pretty poor result, at least in terms of getting the maximum clear potential for George here. I'm trying to debate exactly how he wants to remove things. And it looks like he's going to take out all the small minions and leaves Sarasi with just that Doomguard. Mm-hmm. This protects his Knife Juggler about as well as he can, although that Direwolf Alpha, a nice draw for Sarasi here, as it does allow the Possessed Villager to clear off the 2-2 without the Doomguard having to attack into it.
Yeah, it's very true. And Sarasi can continue to reload, as we talked about earlier. The Doomguard being able to get multiple minions back has really helped Sarasi keep up in resources, even after, you know, playing cards that normally have that big downside. So normally the Hunter, if they can stabilize at any point, if they can keep the board how George has kept it under control and not take too much damage, Call of the Wild will wreak havoc on the board. But Sarasi being able to have those resources shouldn't fall behind if he's able to keep picking up minions.
And it's going to be a nice Librarian with an empty hand, exactly how you want to play it. So when that Librarian dies, it'll give Sarasi even more resources, and he is the one who has a bit of a resource advantage here.
Ooh. Barnes is great because it fits his curve perfectly and has the chance to get something really substantial. Ooh, not substantial. It also puts an extra token on the board to make Call of the Wild a little bit more powerful, which is incredibly important.
We are getting into George C's Call of the Wild turn just next turn, and Sarasi has to be trying to figure out how to maneuver around that. He has a lot of life to work with and the advantage on the board, so I expect that this will be pretty tough for George to come back from, even with Call of the Wild.
Well, I don't know. Sarasi's going to be out of resources this turn.
True.
He's going to trade off most. I think he's going to trade off his whole board. Well, I guess he's going to draw one extra card, but George will be able to clear off the Dark Tyrant Councilman with Call of the Wild.
Yeah, actually, this this is looking like it is potentially. Ooh, that Houndmaster draw is pretty nice, too. So, George, the Silver or Golem draw as well for Sarasi is pretty weak. He would have loved to pick up something like, say, Soulfire here. If he does find Soulfire to go with the Golem, it'd be fantastic, giving him a little bit of mana efficiency. Oh, there's... Eh?
Well, now Soulfire becomes very great.
If he were to draw Malchazar Soulfire.
Malchazar Zimps and then taps into a Soulfire, it'd be incredible. I mean, I guess he'd have enough mana to play the Silver Golem anyway, so it wouldn't really matter.
Defender of Argus is pretty nice. But that Silver War Golem, this is one of the situations where the discard zoo can be a little bit inconsistent, because Silver War Golem, when you have to naturally play it, is so inefficient for what zoo wants to be doing. And you know, Sarasi would love to have, say, an attack boost here, so he were able to attack through that Misha without losing his entire board. He does have the ability to play his Shield Bearer and play Defender on his Imp, along with perhaps the Shield Bearer, to clear that and get a little bit more damage in, but... You know, not quite the explosive turn he'd like to have. He also, notably, is out of Doomguards. So his ability to do anything particularly powerful at this point is pretty limited.
Yeah, it's very limited. And I like this play because it sort of plays around, a little bit plays around Houndmaster. And George picks up Fiery Bat this late in the game. Not the greatest, but sometimes just having extra bodies on the board against the Zoo Warlock is... going to be pretty beneficial. He's also, Sarasi's running out of health.
Yeah, Sarasi low on both cards in hand and life, both of which are pretty crucial at this stage. Does find a Voidwalker. There's Soulfire. Maybe a little too late, though. He's able to play the Voidwalker, Soulfire, the Leok, but does have to trade in a minion as well in order to get through. And George C. still has a relatively comfortable life lead left.
It's going to be interesting to see how he's going to navigate these last few turns. In order to clear the board, he has to trade everything. So he's just going to leave it up, leave the Houndmaster up and try and push a little bit more damage this way. I like this sort of sets. Ooh, unleash the Hound!
Dear, that is a huge draw for George. Able to punch through and both for, do, if he wants, some significant damage, but I imagine he's just going to look to control the board here. Sarasi is out of cards in hand and very low on life. Yeah, he's going to go ahead and push down just to 4 life. So Sarasi cannot life tap or he just dies to George's hero power. And that is going to be it. So those Unleash the Hounds, both alongside the Knife Juggler and just there toward the end of the game, coming up very big for George C.
Yeah, and that's going into... what's usually a pretty poor matchup. It's coming around for the Hunter now that they've been building a little bit more towards the early game. So George has a 3-0 lead now. Going to be really tough for Sarasi to come back, but we're going to move into game number 4 right after this.
Outside of Hearthstone, is there anything else that you like to do? Any hobbies that you have?
Yeah, I play the piano.
Oh, the piano, really?
Yeah, for like 10 years.
So you talked to me a little bit before about the Scouts. So tell me a little bit about that.
I do it for about 10 years now. And once a year, there's always the big trip. 2 years ago, we were in Sweden, for example. This year, in Italy, 2 weeks. So yeah, that's always the highlight of the summer, basically.
Did they play Hearthstone with you, or do they know about your success?
Yeah, it became a topic because of the prelims, of course. Some of them also play the game, but like really casually. I skipped 2 days of the trip to get to the prelims. When I was on stream, they were all at home and met with each other to watch the games. They know I'm here. I guess they watch the games again.
Were you a Boy Scout, Brian Killer?
I was in Cub Scouts. Mm. And then I decided it was not for me.
Why was that, Killer? Not enough dragons.
I actually just wanted to stay home and play games instead. That was what I wanted to do. I was like, I don't want to, you know, build a fire or whatever it is that you go do at the scout meetings.
Turns out there's no Wi-Fi in the wilderness.
Well, I mean, when I was a child, there wasn't Wi-Fi anywhere. Yeah. So.
Come on, Kibler. You're not that old.
I mean, I'm not that old, but Wi-Fi is actually not even that recent of an invention.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess when I was a kid, there wasn't even Wi-Fi.
Yeah. So, screw you, call me old. All right, well, it will be George C. with his Token Druid deck, notably not the Malygos version. The Malygos version has been much more popular among players in the championship so far. George choosing to go with the more traditional, previously Token Druid, gets Astral Communion available off of Raven Idol, which I'm sure people are screaming for him to take. I'm guessing it's going to be Nourish, and it is.
The only time I've ever seen someone take Astral Communion from a Raven Idol in a non-Astral Communion deck was Naaman at Seatstory Cup, just slammed it. And then proceeded to
just get demolished. Just get deck wasn't built for it.
No, he won.
He won.
He like top decked
Nourish,
Nyxia, and then next turn he got Nourish.
That's what happens every time someone Astral Communions against me. Their first draw is always Nourish. I'm just like, what is this? Like,
it was incredibly glorious.
All right.
If you missed it, I recommend watching that.
George
event.
C. did not go for the glory. He went for the high percentage play, as he likes to discuss. Mm-hmm. And has a pretty strong hand here for this matchup. Violet Teacher is... Oh, and there's a pretty strong card. They just picked up Emperor Tharisson coming out on turn number 3. Pretty good.
Yeah, and these are some great cards to have produced as well. You know, it's not the biggest of hands, but Nourish for 4 mana is a huge deal. Drawing 3 cards for 4 mana is, you know, big. Even Swipe for 3 mana allows you to fit that in with extra removal if need be, which a lot of times is needed to clear up modern Zoo Warlocks boards.
So Cerise, he goes ahead and fires off his Soulfire. Interestingly, he did not play his 1-drop first. It allowed him to have a higher chance of keeping the Doomguard in his hand, but prevented his development of an additional minion this turn. Mm-hmm.
And Charles Meyer Keeper, so this presents an interesting option here. He can clear off the Darkshire Councilman if he wants with the Swipe, but Swipe is such a high priority card in this matchup. He can just decide to draw cards with Nourish, or he can just play the Meyer Keeper for either ramp or the 2-2, since he has Violet Teacher Swipe the following turn.
It's definitely an interesting spot here, because the Swipe is not clear. It only allows him to remove the Councilman. The Imp will still survive. And as you mentioned, not really a terribly efficient turn the following turn, because he doesn't really have great availability in terms of his mana to play multiple things. Is looking like he's just going to go with Swipe, though. This does remove the biggest threat, one of the biggest threats in the deck. It's worth noting that Cerise's build as the discard version is not quite as built to go wide. It doesn't have any copies of the Forbidden Ritual, so Swipe is not nearly as high a priority for that particular impact later in the game.
There's only a single minion in the game. Well, I guess 2 minions if you count Possessed Villager that have 1 health, and that's Abusive Sergeant. So he realizes that Swipe probably not going to find great uses later on in the game, so he might as well fit it in while he can. I can't really blame him for that. So, Crazed Alchemist will get permanent stats, so it'll effectively buff the Malkazar's Imp by 1 attack.
So fancy. But George finds a Living Root, so he does have an answer to that Imp, which is pretty big deal given that Cerise is going into a Doomguard turn, and as we see, it does have Doomguard in hand. So it takes down the Imp, picks up a Student for his trouble, and will attack to get 1 damage on the Direwolf Alpha to ensure it is vulnerable to either his Student or his Hero Power next turn.
It's a really good observation to make there is the fact that Living Roots on the Imp is usually superior in that case because of the fact that even though Direwolf Alpha provides an extra 1 damage the following turn, being able to not draw 2 cards is huge. But there's Silverware Golem.
Yeah, we saw that Golem really look unimpressive last game, but here Cerise picks it up at the perfect time, giving him a huge board state that may nearly be insurmountable at this point for George. He has no ability to double spell this turn. Would love to have a little bit more mana to Fandral Nourish. And here he has to be thinking, you know, okay, what combination of draws allows me to actually get back to this game? And I think goes with the minion here. What he's looking at is the fact that next turn he can Fandral Nourish, and if Nourish draws Wrath, he'll have the 2 mana available that can actually allow him to Wrath and kill the Doomguard thanks to the Fandral bonus.
And also, since he's nourishing next turn, he doesn't need the extra mana crystal the following turn either.
Correct.
He because he'll be a 2/2.
Yeah. So definitely, you know, identifying the appropriate sequencing of these particular effects from George here, but still in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, very much so. And he does have four opportunities to win with this Druid deck, though, so definitely has to try and pace himself and realize that some of these matchups are going to be a little bit tougher than others, especially towards the beginning, as Rossi is probably going to queue up the ones that are a little bit more favored. And he's going to continue to push damage here, which is, you know, one of the ways he beat Druid, just knock him out of the game before they can get to that super late game.
All right, well, there is Wrath, so that is a very crucial draw for George. He will, I imagine, Fandral into Nourish, which, because of the Fandral effect, will give him the ability to draw three and two mana crystals to be available right away. So that Wrath is online immediately. Is he actually just Wrathing? I'm actually quite surprised by this decision.
He wants to fit in the hero power, I suppose?
Yeah, the hero power does let him take something down. All right. No, this does give him the ability to clear off the abusive sergeant this turn, which I'm a little surprised by this because he still is going to need to find more help to win this game, and there's still a lot of draws that can be pretty bad for him from Serasi here. But George taking, I suppose, a pretty conservative line by ensuring that he just clears as much as he can off the board immediately.
This does not give him the out of Yogg-Saron should he draw next turn.
That was actually one of the things I was thinking as well, that if he does get really far behind, Nourishing allows him to get to 10 mana, which opens up Yogg as an out.
Also gets him the cards immediately so he can think through his plan a little bit further. Maybe he is trying to hedge around the fact that Defender of Argus, there's still two in the deck.
It's true.
So leaving two minions on the board could punish him much more than leaving one but having extra cards. So definitely some solid consideration for the play that he made, but it's just an interesting line, not one that's obvious or a play that a lot of people would go for. So Living Roots being picked up is a bit of a big deal because it's just removal.
And there's Yogg. So if he had played the Nourish last turn, it would have been possible for him to Yogg this turn if he so chose. He still has a pretty strong sequence available to him here. He has the Living Roots, which will double up. If he does play Arcane Giant, or rather, not Arcane Giant, Azure Drake, that's the card I meant, it does allow him to remove the 3/3, but he won't be able to use his hero power. Looks like he's just going to choose the Violet Teacher, that's the name of that card.
Yeah.
Thinking Arcane Giant, Azure Drake, I have an A on my mind, and now this puts him, he kills the 2/2, so he gets one more minion, and he's at 6. So he's not dead to a plus 2 attack. He's still dead to a Soulfire or a Doomguard here.
Of which there are still two left, one Doomguard and one Soulfire.
But Serasi does not find either.
Mm-hmm.
So George hanging on by a thread here.
Yeah. Interesting to see also last turn, George decided to go for the Violet Teacher over the Arcane Giant, opting for a 3/5 and one extra token as opposed to an 8/8. Because he did have the same, it would have been the same exact amount of mana. And I guess the one extra attack is what he was trying to go for. In this turn, it actually kind of matters. He can't fully clear the board without taking extra damage. But I guess it's okay to hero power because whatever deals one damage would also end up dealing 5 damage in that, or 4 or 5 with Soulfire and Doomguard in that case. I can't think of a single card other than Dark Peddler into Elven Archer or Stone Tusk board that would change that.
And there's. He's got Innervate Yogg if he wants it.
But does he want it? That's the question. It looks. That attack going face means that, yes, he is going for Innervate Yogg.
It is time for Yogg-Saron.
Risky play.
He's at 3 life, so Hellfire will kill him.
Unless he heals himself first.
Time waits for no one.
And vanish. Ooh. All right. Well, this now makes any possible burn spell really threatening. He's building up some taunts here.
Okay.
Killed one of them, though.
Oh, no. Shouldn't have buffed one back up. So Soulfire is still a kill. Call of the Wild.
Oh, dear.
He didn't get the attack in with the Huffer, but I the animations, it was the last spell cast, so.
Soulfire will still end the game, and it is not here. And Serasi concedes. George C. wins the match 4-0.
Wow. And a bold call to play the Yogg there at the end, but pays off as he's able to secure the victory. I suppose almost any other line of play with that case scenario would have won him the game anyway.
I mean, Yogg was obviously very impressive there, but George, he was in a position where if he did just clear off that minion and play an Arcane Giant, he's in a great spot regardless. Mm-hmm. So Yogg wins in dramatic fashion, but given what Sarasi had available to draw, he was going to lose that game regardless.
Yeah. So George C, an impressive performance, 4-0, and we're going to get a few words with him on the stage with Frodan.
All right, thank you so much, TJ. I'm joined by George C. 4-0, looking like it was pretty smooth sailing, even from the get-go, getting a pretty good matchup. So why don't you just talk about some of those high points, people seeing, like, you know, the Tyrion off the mulch and being able to see the highlights. But you felt like you were in control the entire time, right?
Yeah, I mean, Malygos Druid against Control Warrior. Control Warrior is, like, super favored if you know how to play the matchup. His deck, like, it had no pressure at all, so I was just constantly gaining life, and I was pretty favored anyway. And then the same with the Hunter. If I get Juggle Unleashed before, like, Call of the Wild to clear the board up, then I'm favored anyway. And then in the last Druid game as well, just the last game you saw, the Yogg, I had double Ancient of War Feral Rages out, so it wasn't, like, super lucky. It was lucky, but I still had lots of cards that could have given me the same outcome.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, a job well done. 4-0, it has to do wonders for your confidence. Going into day number two, you're feeling good, right? Because people were saying Freeze Mage might not be good, but you're talking about playing the lineup that you like, so your confidence must be really high right now, right?
Yeah, I mean, if you enjoy decks more, you're more likely to play them better because you understand it more, you want to learn a bit more. Whereas if you play decks like Face Shaman, you don't enjoy it, but you play it because it's good, then, like, you're not going to play as well as with a deck you enjoy.
All right, and there it is. So, George, see, I'm so proud of you, man. 4-0. Congratulations. A strong start to the Summer Championships for Europe. In the meantime, we're going to get ready for our next match.